These are the Sawtooth Mountains, perhaps Idaho's most iconic mountain range in central Idaho. I'm looking west towards the Sawtooth Mountains, which just have this impressive and dramatic skyline with these kind of toothy, serrated ridges. There's snow fields up there still in late June. If we kind of turn this way, we're looking south into the headwaters region of the Salmon River. You might be able to see the Salmon River down here near Highway 75. We've got the fish hatchery just below us here. And then just over this ridge is Redfish Lake, one of the more popular attractions in this area. This video is going to focus on a little bit on the mountains themselves, but also these glacial moraines and some of these glacial deposits in this area. So we'll start with the mountains. The rocks in the Sawtooths are an Eocene, about 50 million year old granite. It's very hard and resistant. It's kind of pinkish when you get up close to it. That's what forms these sort of serrated, toothy mountains in much of the Sawtooths. And then the big player here are the glaciers. And so we've had these large U-shaped canyons. We're looking up Redfish Canyon there with Mount Habern and the Grand Mogul, the two kind of big mountains on either side guarding the entrance to the canyon. I believe this is Fishhook Creek here. But we can see even in the high country, these sort of U-shaped broad troughs in the mountains along the skyline there. And these were all formed by glaciers. And if you know a little bit about the climate of Idaho, both, you know, 20,000 years ago and today, you can kind of help explain and understand how these big glaciers might have formed. So what's interesting here is the Sawtooths, as imposing and dramatic as they are, the summits of the Sawtooths are only at like 9,000-10,000 feet. So large, but we have much bigger mountains. In fact, to the east of here, you can't see them, but a couple mountain ranges over, maybe, I don't know, 70 miles as the crow flies, is a much bigger mountain range called the Lost River Range. And that has the highest point in Idaho, Boar Peak, over 12,000 feet, along with other summits that are 11 or 12,000 feet or higher in elevation. What's interesting though is here in the Sawtooths, we have so much more evidence of dramatic glacial erosion. So the glaciers that existed in the Sawtooths were larger and did a much bigger job of eroding the landscape. There were glaciers in the Lost River Range, especially on the east sides, but they're much smaller. And so that might ask you to wonder, well, why would a mountain range taller, 11, 12,000 feet, have much smaller glaciers than a smaller mountain range like the Sawtooths with summits of only 9 to 10,000 feet? And if you think about the climate or the weather systems that we get here in Idaho, we get Pacific storms that come across Oregon into Idaho, and the Sawtooths are really the first big imposing mountain range that they hit. And so in the winter time, a lot of snow is dumped here in the Sawtooths. And as those same storm systems drift east to the White Cloud Mountains, which are kind of just over this ridgeline here, and then to the Lost River Range and the Limhi Range and the Beaverhead Range, they drop a little less snow as they go, even though those are much higher mountains. And to grow a glacier, you need snow. You need snow that falls in the winter and then sticks around through the summer. So if you have a cool enough climate that you can get that snow to persist, so that by the time the next snowfall comes, the next winter, you can add to that snow accumulation in that base. Now you're on your way to growing a glacier. And if you imagine that playing out winter after winter for hundreds of years or thousands of years, that's when you get the snow basically consolidating into glacial ice. And then it starts to move from high elevations to low elevations under the influence of gravity. And so the glacier will advance as far as the mass that's kind of guiding it and the gravity will allow. So what we have here in the Sawtooths, this entire forest covered ridge just on the other side of the highway, these are what we call glacial moraines. In fact, this big one here, we can't quite see Redfish Lake because it's just beyond this, but this is the Redfish Glacier Moraine. So basically, the Redfish Glacier was the largest of all the glaciers in the Sawtooths. It had lots of tributaries that fed it up in the mountains. And as it came down into the valley, you can think of a glacier kind of as, think of it as a bulldozer, but also think of it as a conveyor belt. It's carrying the ice down slope, but it's also carrying all the rocks embedded in it. rocks that have fallen onto the glacier, rocks encased in the ice itself. Of course, those rocks embedded in the ice scours out the mountainside, creates the U-shaped canyons, creates striations. I featured those in one of my other videos previously. And then as it moves out onto the valley floor, the glacier will advance as long as there's more snow and ice being accumulated to it than what it's losing. And in this case, the glacier has advanced all the way down across the Stanley Basin and actually impinged over here up against these steep hills that lead up into the White Cloud Mountains to the east. And so if you imagine ice coming all the way down and impinging against that hillside down here, just below that is the Salmon River. And so what we have evidence for here is we have evidence that these glaciers, especially the Redfish Glacier, actually dammed up the Salmon River, caused it to back up, all the water backed up into the upper Stanley Basin and formed a lake, Lake Stanley, for some period of time. And we don't have a good handle on how long it persisted. It might have lasted a few hundreds or maybe a thousand or so years. Eventually, the ice dam either breached or the ice retreated back, the glacier retreated back towards the mountains, allowing the river to flow through. But you can kind of think of these glaciers as sort of like advancing and then retreating and advancing and retreating over time. But these moraines, these ridges of large boulders and sand and gravel that the glacier dumped on its margins, are a record of how far the glacier advanced into the area. And so a beautiful one also down here, you can kind of see where these trees kind of end just about right here. That's the edge of that moraine there. The trees tend to love the moraines because it has a mixture of boulders and gravel and sand and clay. So it moves the water down easily through the soils and can feed the root systems below. Some of the river terraces down here of the Salmon River don't drain as well. And so they tend to not have the trees as much on them. But really dynamic landscape here of glaciers eroding the mountains and shaping the present topography over time. And then glaciers advancing all the way out across where is now the Salmon River today, across the Stanley Basin, at times damming up the Salmon River or disrupting its drainage in its path and depositing these large ridges of glacial till that we call moraine. Some of these are, I think the Redfish Moraine is in places about 1,000 feet tall, a really formidable obstacle. If you get a chance to look at this area on a topographic map or Google Earth, a lot of these just really pop in an aerial view. So the iconic Sawtooth Mountains and a little bit on the glacial story here from the Pleistocene. The glaciers would have been here at most recently, maybe 20, 15,000 years ago, and then they started to retreat. Today in Idaho, we do not have any glaciers. Those are all snowfields up there. Occasionally in an odd year, you might get a couple snowfields that persist. But there seems to be no documented ice left in any of Idaho's mountains today. Even in the Lost River Range, we did have a glacier there in the 80s, but that glacier seems to no longer exist. And so the glaciers are long gone from Idaho, but perhaps one day they will return. So the Stanley Basin, the Salmon River, and the majestic and beautiful Sawtooth Mountain Range of Central Idaho.